Hello, Broquettes, and welcome to episode number 196 of the Reasons I'm Broke podcast. I'm Daniel.
And I'm Kelli.
National news this past weekend, this whole week, has been extremely heavy. Mm-hmm. As a podcast that does take place in the Orlando area, and listeners that are from Florida, and even the whole nation at large, have been hit with something that is horrific, and not something that we ever expect to get to this level. And unfortunately, it is that shooting incident that happened here in Orlando. And we do want to first off thank all the listeners that checked in on us that day. It was very thoughtful of anyone to, of course, send any kind of messages our way. Kelli and I are largely, we're okay. Mm-hmm. I think everyone, our immediate family, thankfully, was not affected by the tragedy, but a lot of our coworkers and customers and guests, our friends, there's a heavy heart there, and it's all because of a senseless incident that is, unfortunately, and I hate to say, is something that caused the nation to stop for a minute and think about what kind of world we live in. And how serious this all really is.
Absolutely. As Daniel said, we weren't directly impacted, but I know people who were, and waking up that next morning not knowing what had happened and just seeing everything on Facebook and then going into work and seeing all these, you know, people and friends and coworkers who just spent the day checking up on their friends, just trying to make sure their friends were okay. It was absolutely heartbreaking that we as a city had to go through something like this. But, you know, I do want to give the biggest thanks to the first responders, to the paramedics who were helping out with that. And for a whole, as our city, the way that we came together is something that I never thought I would see in my lifetime. And it's terrible that it took this tragedy for that to happen, but I'm sure you've all seen the hashtag Orlando Strong or hashtag Orlando United, and that's really what this incident has done for this city.
The city, as I mentioned in the post earlier this week, is so full of optimism compared mm-hmm. to where I used to live, which was Chicago, and it's not a knock on that city or that state. They're just very different. And something I've always noticed with the people here is there's always a sense of positivity with them. And I wasn't sure as to how this was going to affect that. It's something I always admired about the people here. And it didn't. It made that optimism stronger. And in spite of the awful shit that is hard to avoid that you see online that people say about this, the people here remained not only optimistic, didn't get cynical, but they did not hesitate in giving help. Mm-hmm. There was so much aid given to the blood drives that they had to turn people away. There are so many supplies that are given to those same blood drives and to the funding of for these families that they're saying that we have so much of this that we may not be able to use it all. It may go bad before we're able to use it. That's an amazing problem to have. Mm-hmm. It's beauty that came out of this. And I think that's what was important about this tragedy and the way that we all reacted against it, because And I'm telling this to everyone as well, in case you do view this and you were more affected than we were by this. Don't let this allow cynicism to get in you. Take this and view the good that people are doing, the good that people are saying. Ignore the nonsense. Ignore the negativity, the spin on this to try to, for maybe all politicians, you know, pushing this as an agenda, whatever it may be, and just focus on the people, because we're the ones that are out there living in this world, more affected, more in contact with this very real world. And take that, take what how we responded to it. I ask that you view the beauty of it, and if you helped, amazing, great. And just continue to support not only the people here in Florida, but the people around you, yourselves, the people that may be questioning humanity due to this, and show them that there's so much good that came from these ashes.
Before we do begin our show, though, we just want to have a moment of silence for all the people, 49 people who lost their lives, again, in this very senseless act of ultimately hate.
Hello, and once again, welcome to the Reasons I'm Broke podcast, bringing you the reasons we're broke every week, ranging from comics, movies, TV, video games, and more. I'm Daniel.
And I'm Kelli.
So, Kelli, I think I've found that I have fallen into the Funko Pop trap.
Yes, you have.
Not based on the seven pops, which pale in comparison to what a lot of people have in their collection.
But would you like to tell people where those seven pops are?
They're in our room on top of the dresser.
Predominantly displayed in our room. There's nothing else there except socks and your Funko Pops.
That rhymes. Socks and Funko Pops. That's going to be the episode title this time.
Socks and Funko Pops. Okay.
And so here's how I knew. I'm like, okay, I'm fucked. I pre-ordered 4 more pops.
Where am I going to put your pops?
We'll be moving soon. We'll find a spot. I've gotten the Imposter Batman Pops. So these are kind of like the Vinylmations where they have the Mickey Mouse figurine, okay, and then they put different patterns on it. So in this case, it's Batman as the pattern, and I pre-ordered the Scarecrow one, which reminds me of Winnie the Pooh because it's got the stitches, but in Batman form. It looks beautiful. I got the Poison Ivy one. Great design. Poison Ivy Batman. And then there's a Harley Quinn Batman.
That's pretty cool.
So if you can imagine, it's almost like these villains and characters are wearing the cape and cowl over their regular suit, or made a cape and cowl made out of their suit. So I got those 3. And then the last one is Space Ghost. And it glows in the dark. and he's shooting forward.
I don't know where I'm going to put your Funko Pops. When we move, you're just going to have a room for your comics and Funko Pops. And I will let you decorate it as you please, but the rest of the house is mine.
I'm going to turn into one of those guys that says, I've got my man cave that she lets me have.
Yeah, that's going to be it. There's your man cave.
I always imagined there was going to be, these are our things. And we would decorate like a Beauty and the Beast poster and like a Batman Mask of the Phantasm poster.
Yeah, but that can be in your man cave.
I'm not going to call it a man cave. It's going to be like a bat cave, if anything.
All right.
I don't want to be one of those man caves.
Or it can be like the comic room.
The comic room is fine, too.
Okay. I will even set up, a little theater screen in there for you, so, you can project your movies on there.
I would love that so much, and then eventually, I couldn't install actual theater seats, but I've seen that in rich people's houses, where they have the a theater.
I mean, you could get some really nice-ass recliners in there. Call it a day.
Just match them all up, have them in black, and...
Yeah. Yeah, I mean...
Line them up in rows.
You just need, 2 in there. What do you need more than 2 recliners for?
And I can use comic boxes. If I want to do different heights of rows, I'll just put some fucking full comic boxes underneath there. Fill them with bricks. And use those as stools and steps.
Or, if you really want seating like that, we can make it happen somehow. Why don't we start with 2 recliners with a little table with some cup holders in the middle of it. And a projector.
But Twitter user Brokehead, he's also back around Patreon, at The Irish on Fire, did ask us, what do you think about Funko Pops? Will they be a long-lasting brand or the new Beanie Baby? Also, if you do like them, which ones would you like to see made?
I think Funko Pop will soon go the way of the Beanie Baby.
Agreed.
Because, how many more times can you release kind of the same thing? And then soon, what is it, people our age buying these things?
People of all ages. I've seen several adults, but those are mainly speculators that think that they're going to flip these in 10 years and, make some kind of double or triple
Beanie
profit.
Babies.
Like the Beanie Babies.
Yes, exactly. It's going to go the way of the Beanie Baby. Soon we're all going to have responsibilities where we won't have expendable income for Funko Pops.
I think the biggest tell for me that this is going to be the way of the Beanie Baby is I work in retail, and a lot of these Funko Pops, let's say they stopped making Spider-Man, and they did for a little while, but then Funko decided to print more and make more. So this is not a limited thing for a lot of these designs. Mm-hmm. They let them rest. They let them sit for about a year, year and a half, and then they print out another run of them. And yes, there are previews exclusives, and there's certain Target exclusives. And the fact that there's now Walgreens exclusives and 7-Eleven carries them, that tells me that this thing is, one, being overshipped, but two, being overproduced. And when they're not numbered and they're not really that exclusive, that tells me that there's just simply no collectible value to this. I don't see any comic shop collecting these later in 10 years and saying, hey, we're buying Funko Pops, and then like making some kind of profit on that. It's simply not going to happen. And I don't mean to like burst anyone's bubble if they're actually collecting these simply to resell them.
The broquette sleeping on the bed of Funkos right now is like,
you motherfuckers. But, you know, that goes back to the lesson of buy what you like. And, you know, the collectability of it will come in some of the things that you pick up. And I think that's the biggest thing with comics.
That being said, though, I do like them. And there are probably others that I would like to see. Which ones would you most like to see produced?
I do want to see a whole line of Batman the Animated Series pops.
Ah, that'd be cool.
Because they've already done several of the Batman different versions. And they just announced the Dark Knight Returns line of them.
That's
one of which will be like the Armored Batman. Not the Armored Batman from BVS, but the Armored Batman from the comic. And then there's a previews exclusive, which is going to be a comic shop exclusive, of that same Armored Batman. And they're actually both exclusives, which, again, tells you this is not really a fucking collectible thing. of one without his helmet. So you see Old Man Bruce with his hair slicked back, old white hair, and he's got his fucking wrinkles. That's the one I'm also going to eventually get. And they've got the Joker and all that. But an animated series line, and also a full The Iron Giant line. Like, if I can get, you know, Dean and Hogarth's mom, and I forgot the detective's name as well. I want to get him, but he has to come with a little chocolax shake. It was a Mansley.
Mansley, yes.
Where's the giant Mansley? That was my favorite line. Like, he's like, what? Like, you're an idiot. You fucking sent the missile right here where we're fucking standing. You dumbass. All because he freaked out.
Ugh, that movie gets me every time.
Coming out on Blu-ray so soon. I've got it pre-ordered already. It's as soon as it releases, it is going to be shipped straight to my fucking, straight to my, like, wherever I am. I want them to just drone it to work, drone it to fucking Taco Bell, drone it to Wawa, wherever I am. Wherever I am at that time. It better drop that Iron Giant right there. I cannot wait.
I'm going to cry so much. Why do you want me to cry in high definition?
I'll cry too. in high definition. It's going to be so gorgeous. Just like when you saw Winnie the Pooh on Blu-ray for the first time.
Oh, stop. It was wonderful. I need to watch that again. Love that movie.
What about for you? Were there any particular pops that you wanted to see? I know they've done Winnie the Pooh in the past, and they've done some of the Beauty and the Beast ones as well.
I like all of those. I think the thing for me, so I was really big into the Vinylmations when they first came out, which, for those of you who don't know, because, you know, it's really mostly a Disney thing. It's a little Mickey Mouse shaped, and then they paint over them to be the different characters. So I was huge into those, and we got all the Haunted Mansion ones and all the
villains.
Beauty and the Beast. We got the villains, and I mean, they're all really cool, and I like to look at them.
Me too.
But they just kind of sit in the case.
Yeah, and I think they make a great display. Like, I love just every now and again just looking at them, seeing the complete set. There's like a finality and like a accomplishment to just looking at that nice display. But yeah, go ahead.
And I mean, I agree with that. It's cool to see them. But I think I'm at like the stage of my life now where I'm like, okay, I could spend my money on something that's going to sit in a case, or I could go and have this experience. You know, for example, we went to a brewery recently, and the money that I spent on the brewery, I could have bought one Funko Pop with, you know, which one at the end of the day is what I'm spending my money on. So, I mean, I would like to see cool ones, like Pokemon would be really cool, not that that's ever going to happen, but of course things that I like, Kingdom Hearts, which I think they've made some of those too, haven't they?
I haven't seen any of those. Okay, I haven't seen any Zelda ones either.
Kingdom Hearts would be really cool. Fire Emblem would be cool for me to see
too.
Oh yeah,
that'd be great.
But is it something that I think personally I'm going to go out and spend my money on? No, probably not.
And while we're at it, we did also put out a question of the week for the last episode. And we asked Broquettes, in relation to Injustice 2, which heroes and villains do listeners want to see in that sequel?
The answer we got was from @CubanSlim, who said, Injustice 2 wishes, Firestorm, Ra's, Alfred, Poison Ivy, Robin, Cheetah, Vixen, Mr. Freeze, or Captain Cold. Injustice 2 wish number 2, lantern that can be toggled on character select to be others from different lantern colors, just like Bowser Jr. and Super Mario Brothers.
They toyed with that in the first game. Mm-hmm. When you bought the DLC for Injustice, Hal Jordan could be switched on over to Jon Stewart as part of a different skin.
Yeah.
And even the voice changed.
Oh, that's so
and
cool.
That was the coolest thing, because it's like every time I played as Green Lantern, I'm like, oh, fucking Jon Stewart every fucking time. and I had Sinestro as well, so mm-hmm. I had my two favorite Green Lanterns right there. And then the default Hal Jordan. Yeah, that's a great idea. Like, you can toggle between Kyle Rayner, Jon Stewart, mm-hmm. Hal Jordan. Yeah, I don't think Kilowog would work with the same model, so he'd have to be like a part of the special or a separate character. As Ra's al Ghul has to be in this. I mean, from that first trailer that we talked about, when you hear Ra's in the background, there's no way he's not in that game. He has to be in it. And then Firestorm is another good one. I think it would be a good DLC character, especially with the popularity of the Flash. Poison Ivy. I almost thought that she was a character already, but she definitely wasn't. Not mm-hmm. yet. Robin, there's a couple different ones you can use with Robin, too.
I think you kind of missed his point about the lanterns, though. So you just listed all Green Lanterns. He's talking about different lantern colors. So, like, you could turn into a Blue Lantern, or a Red Lantern, or, like, Razor. You could be Razor in the Red Lantern and the Blue Lantern. This is all I need in my life!
And even if you were Hal, you can change into all the different colored ones, because he's been a different lantern before in the past, too.
That's lame.
It's Hal Jordan.
Who wants to be Hal Jordan? I don't want to be Hal Jordan. I want to be, like, Black Lantern Spooky Man.
An intern broke at Acuban Slim said, do you think we will see hashtag Ocean Master in hashtag Injustice 2?
Yes.
Is he going to come on people's faces?
That is the only way that he beats that he defeats people. Because at that point, like, you can't fight anymore. Like that video we saw where the guy was trying to fight the other guy and he pulled down his pants and the other guy ran away. Like, yeah. That's what it's got to be.
So that's how you'd play. You'd play Ocean Master.
Yeah.
And as soon as you pulled off the special, like, the game would be over. It's an instant win.
Special would be him jumping out of the sand.
It doesn't take. He's instantly like he's like an octopus, just like immediately to your face, like just inks you, or like a skunk, like that's what it would be for.
I like the octopus analogy better.
Ocean Master. One of the new designs, I almost want to make like something with Ocean Master. I don't know what I can do. I don't know how I would make it work. I don't know what I could draw out. But I do want to make some kind of design for a t-shirt to all of these ongoing jokes like fucking Ocean Master.
Well, Ocean Master would have to be some man hiding in the sand with like just his penis sticking up.
Like his mask. You'd see the mask and then the sand.
And like his nose. You'd have to have his nose in there because this is all things that stick above sand.
So and of course his dick.
And then his penis.
I don't know how many people would wear that.
I
think without the dick, I think that's sellable. Like the mask or underneath the...
Okay, fine. That's probably sellable. But in real life, his penis is sticking up too.
He'd also have to have one of his eyebrows cocked like all the Disney movies have now. Like, ooh. We're edgy. Look at our characters.
Is that what they all do now in Disney?
They
movies?
Do. Like, it used to be only DreamWorks that did that.
Mm-hmm.
But now it started with Tangled. Like, they had, oh, the prince has a beard now. Oh, look at their
eyes.
He
wasn't a prince. He was a thief.
Whatever.
And he just needed someone to love him.
And now
his name was Eugene.
Frozen, and both the sisters, the Frozen sisters, have like their arms crossed and kind of like not exactly happy 100%.
The Tangled prince was the cutest prince ever. When he was at Disney, do you know how long the line was to meet him? I heard this story the other day. So Rapunzel and Flynn Rider were at Disney, right? As meet and greet characters. When Flynn Rider was there, it was a 6-hour wait to meet them.
Not worth it.
6 hours.
Not worth it.
Because all the moms wanted to be there. They took away Flynn Rider. You know how long that line was?
2 hours.
An hour.
Jesus.
1 hour, because they got rid of Flynn Rider.
So that appealed to older women.
Yes.
More than anything. So what was it? I mean, I can't...
I mean, he's,
I don't know what
he's
it
like,
is.
He's a bad boy.
Is it because he has a little... Like, it's the first Disney character, male, that has...
With the
that's
goatee.
Good, that has, like,
I
a
mean,
little goatee thing.
His goatee is cool, but he was like, he was a bad boy. You're like, oh my. Like, he was a bad boy with a good heart. He goes around stealing things, but then he takes her to see lanterns and the way he looked at her when she was looking at the lanterns.
Sounds to me like Aladdin.
Like,
he was a thief. He took her away
but
to
Aladdin
show her the world.
Like a skinny boy. This is like a man. Flynn Rider is a man. He's
well, he was
shit.
Older.
Yeah, but like Aladdin, and then Aladdin lied and all this shit. Flynn Rider never lied.
I've only seen the movie once, so I can't call you out on whether he lied or not.
We should watch it again. And not just because he's handsome.
So most of today's episode, Brocats, and it might be a shorter one, but that's because the biggest news, and this is what took over all the news outlets, including Newsarama, and it was all over Kotaku, was E3 2016. Now, if we're going to highlight a bunch of the stuff that relates to some of the bigger stuff, like Resident Evil 7. I've played Resident Evil in the past, so I'm going to touch on that. But if you want to see the full highlights of everything at E3 2016, you're going to head on over to Kotaku.com. They put up a great article that I think is everything at E3 2016 this year, and they've been updating that article with all of the brand new stories, all of the brand new videos with links to everything. Great job on Kotaku. Props to them. But here's some of the stories and some of the games that we picked out for this week for the listeners.
So the first one, like you mentioned, is Resident Evil 7. I think you once said Resident Evil 4 was your favorite game of all time.
It is still one of my favorite games of all time, and I think it is actually my favorite game of all time. Resident Evil 7 is a first-person game compatible with PlayStation VR. There is a demo right now for PlayStation Plus members, and it is set to release on the PS4, on the Xbox One, and for the PC.
And this will come out January 24th, 2017.
They are saying that it's going to go back to the roots of horror for Resident
Evil. No, I don't like spooky games, except for Dead Space.
That is something that people have been asking for from the Resident Evil franchise for some time now. Resident Evil 4 was so well received, and so it sold extremely well that they continued with that formula. And Resident Evil 5 came out, and I enjoyed it. It was solid, but it wasn't Resident Evil 4. Then Resident Evil 6 came out, and it went full-on action and adventure and all kinds of craziness. Even the engine, I think, changed from the previous Resident Evils, and it was just destroyed as far as reviews. So now, gamers are to the point where they said, we have too much of this action that you should have only given us maybe once or twice. We want to go back to what Resident Evil was.
Which was the game with the Chainsaw Man?
That was Resident Evil 4.
No, but there was that other Chainsaw Man. Remember, you used to play the demo all the time, and it had the lady and the guy in Africa.
That was Resident Evil 5.
That was terrifying. That was so scary. I don't like those games.
Great game, also. I liked it. But I think Resident Evil 7, I'm not going to be able to get. And it's only because, yeah, some of you can't play it with PlayStation VR, but one theme I saw throughout all of E3... is that VR is going to be the thing that these console manufacturers are going to focus on. And it's not going to be an entirety to the whole system. It's not like they're going to come out with, this is the new Xbox and it's just a VR headset. But it is a component that they are working into. And I think it could go the way of like the Kinect or the PlayStation, what was that called? The PlayStation Move, where they're like, okay, let's see if it does well. And then when it doesn't, they'll eventually phase it out. They're going to have VR compatible to all these different games. And these different titles are going to be launch titles just to showcase VR. I don't know. Maybe I'm too old and I'm not playing video games as often. But as I said before, I am not one to champion or get behind virtual reality. Maybe, you know, call me old school or call me extinct or whatever, but I like sitting on the couch with a controller. This is another reason why Star Fox wasn't up my alley. I don't want to be moving around, and I just want to have precise controls and have it beat that, you know? Focus on the gameplay, but I don't know if this is gamers asking for VR. I don't work at GameStop anymore, so I can't really gauge any of that interest anymore, but this is what we're getting.
Yeah, Danny, you're just old.
I guess so. Like, something people wanted out of motion controls. Like, I wanted to be able to move and actually see everything. And it looks like they're sort of getting that with the new VRs, where you can actually look around. And I don't know.
I will say I do enjoy those Facebook videos that are the 360-degree views. And I do like to move around and look at those. But everything else, I'm like, I don't even know how to do more than button mashing.
Microsoft also had a slew of announcements. The first one being that the Xbox One Slim is going to release this August, starting at $300.
This will be 40% smaller than the Xbox One, and prices will vary depending on the hard drive size.
So we've got the sizes here. 500 gigs will be $300, 1 terabyte is $350, and 2 terabytes is $400.
2 terabytes? Who will use 2 terabytes of anything?
Well, these games now are taking like 60 gigs, 70 gigs, 80 gigs. The sports games are getting bigger and bigger.
Boy.
So that was one of the main concerns when I got a PS4, because when I worked at GameStop, I looked at the back and on the sizes of these games, and I'm like, holy shit, like, people don't understand that 500 gigs used to be a lot. Not anymore. Not with this current generation.
Do you remember when memory cards used to be 2 gigs and it was a lot?
I remember, yeah.
It's like, oh, yeah, I got this too. Or when you got up to 4 gigs, like, that was something big. I remember my mom gave me a flash drive once that was 500 megabytes. 500 megabytes. And I thought I could never fill that bitch.
And they used to be way more expensive, too. Mm-hmm. That's kind of like that picture of, like, this is what 356 megabytes looked at in the 70s. And it's a computer, but the whole room is a computer.
Yeah.
And now it's, like, a little tiny little flash drive that can fit in your pocket.
Yep.
It's amazing. And I think we're going to see bigger games, bigger hard drives in the future. So if you're going to invest in an Xbox One Slim, I would go at least a terabyte. That's what I ended up getting for the PS4. And I'm not even a heavy gamer.
Ooh, that's too much memory for one person. That's too much power! They've also added a new feature, though, that you would really enjoy and take advantage of. Players will be able to fully color, engrave, and personalize Xbox wireless controllers via xboxdesignlab.xbox.com.
Prices on these start at $79.99. I was immediately reminded of colorware.com.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if gamers, brocats don't know what colorware is, it is a service that's been around for many years, and they will recolor your systems, your controllers, computers, phones, whatever is relevant at the moment and they feel like they can sell, they will recolor it. You can buy it straight from them, choose your colors, and then they send it to you, or you can send in your own system, controllers, that kind of thing. So when I saw this, I immediately went to the design lab, and it's very similar. The colors are not as vast, is something I will let you know, and I'm sure they may add colors later on. But with Colorware, and it is for about the same price, you can choose whether you want a matte finish, a gloss finish, what part of the controller you want to be matte and gloss, more color options. You can do solid colors, you can do it's not like a glitter color, but it's more like a shimmer metallic color that you can do for all the different versions of what you have. So personally, I would still recommend sending in your controller or buying your controller at colorware.com. But this is an option that players do have or gamers do have if they want to also change the buttons. That is one thing you can't do in Colorware is interchanging buttons like the black ones, the white ones, or black lettering against white, white against black. It's strictly the body of the controller, some of the triggers, some of the trackpads on Colorware. But this one will also offer engraving, which again, you can also get on Colorware, but those are two options that gamers do have out there.
A pretty smart option, too. We've seen, especially with phones now, that customization is huge. Everybody wants their own personalized thing, and they'll spend a lot of money for it. So I think this is smart of them to do, and I think it will ultimately bring them a lot of revenue.
Going back to the VR side, Microsoft announced Project Scorpio. And this is a new VR device that will be compatible with all Xbox One and Xbox One S games and accessories. So Xbox One S being, of course, the Slim.
While Microsoft previously had a partnership with Oculus Rift, as announced at last year's E3, there was no mention of that relationship in this week's presentation.
A lot of these partnerships, there's falling outs, there's disagreements against contracts. It could be that they're like, okay, we've seen what the Oculus can do, and maybe we can do better, but maybe the company doesn't want to change that, so that's when they split. Who knows what it is? It's not clear that Oculus Rift is not involved in this at all, but it is interesting that they did not mention that during their presentation. It is still unclear if Project Scorpio is a placeholder title. I know some people have been kind of making fun of the name, comparing it to The Simpsons. I love Scorpio, though, so I hope that they keep it. I love Scorpio from The Simpsons. Or if it's going to be the console's final name.
We'll hold out and see. I'm sure we'll get some more information pretty soon.
The biggest thing that I saw out of Sony's presentation was the new God of War game. This is almost a Last of Us type of title, but with Kratos. It's Last of Us meets God of War.
Were you, like, making love to some ladies in the first part of it? Because that's all I remember from any of those games.
That's the part that they had to remove. It just couldn't fit with that Last of Us theming. Okay. So,
because, you know, I remember, and like I said, this is the only thing I know of this game, is you and your brother were playing it once, and this was many a year ago.
My brother was playing it. Okay, I have never played that game.
You were watching it, fine, whatever, and I walk in, and he's just pressing buttons to have sex with these ladies, and you're just sitting there watching, and I'm like, the fuck are you guys playing? And that's the only thing I know of God of War.
It's God of Sex.
Clearly. <It's a
spin-off. laughs> So this trailer...
God of Whore.
this trailer showed 10 minutes of gameplay and introduced Kratos' new targets, the Norse gods.
That's pretty cool.
It is pretty fucking amazing. Like, that is the one thing that I was like, how are they going to go about this? He's already gone up against Zeus himself, mm-hmm. murdered him, gone against the Titans, gone against the different gods. And Penny Arcade put out this comic that was just a joke thing that was like, okay, so Kratos has pretty much ruled all of Olympus, all of the Greek gods. What's he going to do now? How are they going to make more games? And they're like, oh, don't worry, there's more gods out there. And it's like, God of War 4, and it shows him bloodied up and flying, and there's like Vishnu and Jesus and there's all of these different religions, like they're all like real muscly and they're getting ready to fight. And I'm like, that's true, you can go against the other gods.
Little did he know how accurate they were.
It ended up happening, like, yep. Eventually he'll rule the Norse gods, and then he'll go against the Jewish gods, and he's gonna go against the Aztec gods, and
Aztec gods would be real cool.
Oh, that'd be amazing. Like, it's so stylized that it would also work. Like, the Norse gods is... And you see trolls, you see elves, you're going to see him go up against Thor.
Those my people.
Thor may be the main character, the main villain.
That's my people.
Going after your religion there.
My
the religion of your people.
Are
you German? Because it is more of a northern German religion.
I'm a little bit of everything. I'm a lot of Dutch, which is kind of in that area, but I'm sure I have, like, Viking relatives. I got some Irish in there, some Polish, some Welsh. There's a lot of German. My maiden name is German.
So if someone were to say, what's the biggest ethnicity of you?
Dutch.
Is that the right word? Okay,
yeah.
So it would be Dutch.
It's Dutch. I'm mostly Dutch, yeah.
You should be like my buddy Riggs, which I hope to have on the podcast, who's 10% Irish, but he tells everyone he's Irish. Like, I'm Irish. And he has, like, a little... four leaf clover tattoo on him. And one day I did ask him, I'm like, so you're like 100% or 70? And he's like, nah, I think his mom actually pointed out, like, he's like 10% Irish. And that's what I'm like, oh, Jesus.
Telling just, people you're Irish.
That's the part that he kind of latched onto.
I'm fairly certain that I have more Irish in me than... So my mom's grandparents, their last name was McClish. So, I mean, I'm very closely related to people who came over directly from Ireland. But there's still a lot of Dutch in there, too. But I've never drank Guinness, so it must not be that Irish.
Must not be. Real quick, one last thing before we move on to Rocksteady and their new Batman game is that the God of War series, it did need some kind of refresher because it couldn't just be hack and slash the entire time.
Mm-hmm.
We had already gone up against these different gods. The Last of Us was so successful. It does feel like either Sony or someone behind the scenes told them, you should take this formula and try to make it work with God of War. Some people wanted a different character, someone brand new other than Kratos. And I understand that too. But this is a Kratos now that he's raising a boy. And he's teaching him how to hunt.
Aww.
And he's got this giant beard now. So it's almost like he's trying to rebuild this,
Papa Kratos.
This family that he has. And
Papa Kratos.
I think what is most important about this is there's going to be so much character development. The little boy messes up when they're trying to hunt this deer so they can eat. And he initially gets very upset and instead, like, takes a step back. And it's almost like he's learning as well. Like, he needs to be more patient himself as a man, which he's never gotten before. If you watch any of the God of War games, it's all about ripping someone's head off from their neck, like, just with your hands and fucking those goddesses and all that stuff. And in this case, it's a more grounded Kratos, and I think that's going to be a very good spin and change for the franchise, one that hasn't been seen in a few years now.
Something else that we haven't seen is something like this new Batman game.
How do you feel when you put on that mask? Are you hiding from the world? Or do you want the world to hide away from you?
Rocksteady is not done with Batman. These are developers behind...
Rocksteady will never be done with Batman.
Developers behind Arkham Asylum,
awesome.
City, and
awesome.
Knight.
Awesome.
They are returning to the Batman universe through a VR Batman game.
Well, now, don't knock it till we've tried it.
I'm not going to be able to play this. I'm not going to get PlayStation VR.
You might.
Look, I know I bought a PS4 for one game.
Yes.
But that's with the knowledge that eventually you'd be playing Kingdom of Hearts 3 on it, that I'd be playing MLB The Show. This is not... I don't see myself playing any other games aside from Batman. I don't want to just get a PlayStation VR for the new Batman game, especially after they've said that this is like a 60-minute game.
Yeah, but you get to be Batman.
I get to be Batman in Arkham City. I get to be Batman in Arkham Knight.
Whatever. So this game is exclusively for PlayStation VR. They're advertising it as you get to be Batman. You are playing as Batman through this, yes, 60-minute game. But that's 60 fucking great minutes where you are the Dark Knight.
This is set to release this year, October. The premise, people have already brought it up, they've seen it, they've gotten to play it, is that there's a murder mystery that Batman has to solve. And of course, you're in the eyes of Batman, you're using all the different gadgets and all the different scanning abilities, technology that you have. Except Dick Grayson, Nightwing, has been murdered. You find Nightwing with his neck snapped.
What?
And you gotta figure out who killed him.
I need to figure out who killed Nightwing!
They wouldn't kill Nightwing.
I need to figure this out!
It's not gonna be Nightwing.
What if it's a fucking scarecrow thing and then everything just becomes, like, insane? And so you're Batman going through this creepy-ass scarecrow world. Oh, shit.
It's gonna be a lot of gimmicky, like, things jumping at you.
Yeah!
I don't know. I'm not a VR guy. I don't know. I'm not going to get this.
Watch a Let's Play on it. And
I'm fine with that. I'll watch a Let's Play.
And of course, as we all expected, the biggest portion of E3 this year was Nintendo.
The biggest portion for us, at least.
I'm pretty sure it's the biggest portion for everyone.
Pokemon Sun and Moon, they showcased a brand new trailer, and they gave us three brand new Pokemon.
Yes! So the first brand new Pokemon is Donald Trump. He is a normal type.
Its name is Young Goose, and it does look like Donald Trump. The internet immediately photoshopped Donald Trump, Young Goose, in different poses. You came up with the idea, though. Who would be Young Goose's main enemy?
Hawlucha, clearly. Maybe Luchador Pikachu, but mostly Hawlucha.
The next Pokemon they showcased is Pikachu Peck. And this is a normal flying type.
You did not read that name correctly. Its name is Woodpecker.
That's what you're going to name it if you catch one of these things.
No, I'm naming all my things after Batman things, remember?
This was the Pokemon that gamers pretty much figured out ahead of time, because this is the one that they showed the silhouette of in that very first teaser to Pokemon Sun and Moon, where it was just a wireframe Pokemon. And gamers took that little wireframe
and they
noticed that it had like a longer beak, and they said this is probably what it's going to look like, and they photoshopped it, and they got really fucking accurate to the final design.
I wonder if the creators saw like the Photoshop design, they're like, oh, this is better than our shit.
Let's just use that. Don't ever know.
The last one is called Hermit Crab Thing.
It's called Grubin.
And he is
Hans
a bug type.
Grubin.
Hans Grubin. He is called a hermit crab thing. Is he a hermit crab thing? No, he's like a pincher bug.
It's a weird pincher bug, but he has like a shell. It's a bug type, obviously, but I don't know what it's really based on.
Hermit
it could be
pincher bug.
It could be a hermit crab. We haven't gotten one of those yet.
Yeah, we do.
No, the closest thing is...
That crab that lives under a rock?
I mean, man, it's not really a hermit crab, though.
I would name this Discount Omastar.
They've also, one that wasn't revealed in the trailer, but I told you about, there's a koala Pokemon.
Oh, yeah.
Has, like, a little drum. It looks great. And then there was one more.
I feel like that koala Pokemon with the drum is just high all the time.
It could be. And there's also a new dog type.
Yes.
And I believe it's a ground or a rock type, which I didn't expect. Normally, the dog types end up being normal types.
No, there was that dark one. The dark fire.
Yeah,
Houndoom.
But then... Houndoom, yeah, I guess so. But normally, like, all the little puppies are the cute ones. And even the Pokemon that you see here, I bet you all of these you find near the beginning of the game.
I want a cute little rock puppy. Aww.
This trailer also showed brand new unique animations for the trainers you encounter. That's a first for the series. Mm-hmm. Shadows cast on the field from Pokemon, and the lighting on the battleground changing based on the time of day.
I feel like that's not new.
They've done it in the Red and Blue remakes. I guess it would be Red and Green when they came out in the U.S. I did think it got darker.
Pokemon Silver have been changing the time of day since before you were born.
But for these, like, having the trainers have brand new original animations compared to XY, because we did have that, again, in the older games. But these are all improvements from Omega Ruby and Sapphire, from X and Y. It feels like they're putting a lot more effort into games that arguably take more time to create.
I will purchase this game. I will catch some Pokemans. I will probably still not finish this game.
Well, I've got them. I got to pre-order them. I still have to do that.
You got
to
do that.
I've got to trade in Call of Duty.
Why are you slacking?
And pre-order Pokemon Sun and Moon.
Stop slacking.
But one I may not pre-order is the next one. And I know it's sacrilege. I know people are going to try to crucify me over
this. How dare you?
But it looks like a great game. I'm not going to argue against that. And that is The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild.
Open your eyes. Wake up, Link.
Hours of gameplay and the full trailer were shown during Nintendo's Treehouse event when they said a few months ago that The Legend of Zelda was going to be their main focus for E3. They fucking meant it. I mean, you got so many hours of Zelda, more than enough to fill you until that game releases next year. You can rewatch those 8 hours over and over again for the next, you know, 6, 7, 8 months, and you'll be fine.
Like, all of that will do. How long is this game?
This game is an open, completely open world game. What's the 3DS one you played? In which, kind of like that, in which you can do the dungeons in any order you'd like.
Okay.
It gives you as much freedom as gamers had in the Nintendo version of The Legend of Zelda.
They also showed two new things for this game. Link will now have a jump button and a stamina meter for climbing objects.
There are two things that gamers have asked for in The Legend of Zelda. One is voice acting, so having Link speak, and the other is a jump button. I've always been okay with not having a jump button. That has never been a problem because they incorporate the gameplay and the fact that you don't have a jump button. But the voice acting is something that they don't want to just see dialogue and read it out loud. They want full voice acting in Zelda. And I think it's to bring the world more to life than what we have. They've always argued that Link is the player. This is why he doesn't speak a lot. But for...
Yeah, guys, he's a player. That's why he doesn't speak.
It's supposed to be like you are Link, and that's why they don't want to have him speak. Kind of like in the Pokemon games, too. It's supposed to be you, and you don't really speak. I mean, you see, like, go Bulbasaur and all that, but when you're actually talking to people, you don't see the player. You don't see any dialogue.
...
So I don't know if they're going to change that aspect of it. They haven't really told us. I don't expect them to. But at least two of the new things, jump button and then the all new stamina meter. Yes, we've had another underwater meter and all of that, but a stamina meter that will affect how fast you run, how far you climb, that kind of thing is definitely going to bring a whole new dimension to The Legend of Zelda.
This title will also be more stat-based than any previous Zelda game. Weapons will break, new outfits will raise and lower certain stats, a constant clock in the game will affect areas on the map, and hearts will now be refilled by eating various foods.
Certain recipes will affect how Link moves for a certain amount of time, and players can replenish Link's health by camping and advancing the game several hours.
Certain foods affect my heart too. pasta makes me happy, as does soft serve ice cream, but only vanilla. Can you give Link those foods?
Yeah, you can go to McDonald's and get a McFlurry.
A snack size M&M McFlurry, which they're getting rid of. Stupid Mars candies. That's what we should be talking about today, not this video game shit. Talk about how Mars candies is getting rid of all their candies in fast food restaurants, so I can't have my M&M McFlurries, and I don't like the Oreo McFlurries as much.
Why are they getting rid of them?
Because Mars wants to be healthier or something, and so Mars is looking at McFlurries and saying, oh shit, no one should eat this much, and it's associated with our candy. This is too much sugar, so let's just pull it out of fast food and just sell M&Ms by themselves. But who wants to eat M&Ms by themselves?
I only eat the peanut M&Ms by themselves, and that's very rarely.
Yeah, I only like M&Ms wrapped in in copious amounts of vanilla ice cream and blended with a spoon.
Wrapped in milk sugar.
Yeah, pretty much. Cream sugar, thank you.
So back to Zelda, the game, another brand new feature. You will have a gauge to show Link's body temperature. Players will need to eat certain food or dress Link in a certain clothes to keep his health from dropping.
So, like, when he sees a pretty lady, does his temperature go up a little bit?
I don't know.
I feel like that would play a big effect, too, when you get to, like, the desert or an ice dungeon also.
The biggest example was when you're climbing a mountain, you won't be able to climb any higher unless you have the winter clothes or whatever. Then you can advance to the dungeon that's at the top of the mountain. So that's one of the things, one of the ways in which they'll limit which areas you can actually go to.
So the focus will be on survival and open world exploration. The order of dungeons, like we said earlier, completely up to the players.
Something they did emphasize, though, with the survival portion of it, is you can't starve to death. So it's not going
to
be something that
Okay, good, because I would be the one to starve to death in that game.
You won't constantly have to hunt, and you have X amount of hours to eat or anything like that. That will strictly be, if you take a hit, your heart will go down, so you will have to hunt, and you will have to make food to actually be able to bring those hearts back up. So it won't be super hardcore, but it is going to be brand new to the Legend of Zelda series. And I think something that gamers would have expected with the openness of Hyrule.
Zelda series producer Eiji Aonuma clarified that Link in Breath of the Wild is male. When pushed on the subject, he responded to Kotaku.com with the following quote.
You know, there's the idea of the Triforce in the Zelda games we make. The Triforce is made up of Princess Zelda, Ganon, and Link. Princess Zelda is obviously female. If we made Link a female, we thought that it would mess with the balance of the Triforce. That's why we decided not to do it. If we have Princess Zelda as the main character who fights, then what is Link going to do?
I have a lot of problems with this quote.
I do too. Not because I'm like, you need to have a female, but I'm like, that's not a good excuse, man.
No.
You could have come up with something better.
Yeah, so it's okay to have two guys on the Triforce, but you can't have two ladies on the Triforce?
That's one. That's a really good point. Like, I don't know why that's... He's like, it messes up the Triforce. How's that mess up the Triforce?
Because you need two penises and you can't have two vaginas? I'm very confused.
The Triforce likes to have more penises.
You know what? They should just do a Triforce. They should do a game where Link is a female and Zelda's a female and Ganon's a female. Now what? How's your Triforce now, bitch?
Would you keep the names the same? Still yeah. Ganon, still Link.
Yeah.
I think that's where they fucked up when... They did Hyrule Warriors, the female Link. They called her Linkle. Like, just call her Link. Like, Link is not strictly a male name. Just
yeah, call Ganon. Her Link.
Kind of like Thor right now. It's not female Thor or Thorina. It's just Thor.
Yeah. This really bothers me. And I'm not, like, a super feminist. I'm fine to let men fight battles. Maybe I'm becoming more feminist in my old age.
You could be.
Now that I think about it. Anyway, whatever. But my problem is, like, that's your excuse. Like, oh, it'll mess with the Triforce. Like, where in your creation of this did you say, we need these strictly male characters to be two of the three Triforces? And, what aspects make it clearly male, where one couldn't become female? What's the Triforce? Courage and hope
courage,
and pixie
wisdom,
dust?
And power.
Whatever. So why can't a woman possess courage or power?
Someone else also brought up, and we talked about it too in the past, is why not have a Prince Zelda?
Yeah.
And then have a female Link. Like, what's wrong with a Prince Zelda?
Nothing.
If you don't want to, like, he immediately went to Zelda's going to be the one that fights. It's like, well, no, why don't you just have a male Zelda?
And, I mean, cool. Why can't Zelda fight? Like, maybe Ganon steals Link because he knows Link is important to Zelda and he's trying to fuck with her. Like,
she's fought in the past. In Ocarina of Time, she was Sheik. In Smash Brothers, it's Sheik. Yeah. Like, it's Zelda's not defenseless. And it might have been the Zelda game you played, but in one of the ones, like, she possesses the statue and she fights alongside Link as well.
I don't think it was one I played.
In Wind Waker, Terra is a reincarnation of Princess Zelda, and she was a pirate that was out there fighting as well. So, it's like, making Zelda a hero or a fighter is not a new thing to the Legend of Zelda. I think it's just the way he phrased it and the answers he gave were not the smartest. He could have said something, you know, maybe we'll look into it in the future. Or this is something that we decided to go in the direction that we're given. You're the PR expert. I mean, how would you respond to this?
I probably would have said something of that's certainly a possibility in a future game. We're always thinking of new ways to reinvent the characters, and a female Link or a male Zelda certainly isn't out of the realm of possibility. Boom! What's that? Boom. I like how you say I'm a PR expert, like I was taking classes recently and not like 5 years ago.
You always come up with a better answer, though, than I would. Like, I can come up with something okay, but you can always come up with something way more, like, all-encompassing, super safe.
Because I'm good at bullshitting. I think I told you I had that class where there were three of us, and one person was telling the truth and two were telling lies. And we had to make the people believe, like, all three of us were telling the truth. And I was telling a blatant fucking-ass bold-faced lie, and they all thought I was telling the truth.
That's amazing.
Yes.
The other thing, too, is it could be a DLC thing in the future. So, I mean, they don't want to promise that. But me, as a gamer, I can say, like, if they wanted to, they could do a DLC Linkle if you want. Like, fucking color Linkle, that's fine. do a Linkle playable character in the future. Come out with a Linkle Amiibo.
Amiibo. Linkle Amiibo. Linkle Amiibo.
And anytime you use that Amiibo, it will summon Linkle as a playable character.
I, as a game creator, I wouldn't even do that. I would make a Legend of Zelda game where Link is a female. And Zelda, I haven't decided she could be male or female, whatever. They could be best buds. They're not together anyway. And I would just make a whole game around that. And, you know, there's going to be people who are going to say, no, I'm not going to play this because of that. And then you're going to have even more people who are going to say, that's a really cool concept.
If you want to be the safest, give people options. Just like in Pokemon. Are you a boy or a girl? And then you choose from there.
Cool. I like it. Is Ganon a boy or a girl? But if it's a girl, I want it to still look exactly like male Ganon, but with like
with lipstick. Earrings and lipstick.
And a purse. Can you have a beauty mark too? Like a little mole on his cheek.
I'm thinking of Ursula now from Little Mermaid. That's what I'm thinking of.
Yep, there you go. Somebody draw me this picture.
Needs to happen. Nintendo also had the announcement of brand new Amiibo figurines.
So we have 7 of these. First is Wario. We have Waluigi, Daisy, lame, Rosalina, Boo, who glows in the motherfucking dark.
Hell
that's
yeah.
Awesome. Donkey Kong and Diddy Kong.
People shit on Waluigi as like the worst Mario character. Waluigi is my character in Mario Kart Double Dash, and is also my character in all the Mario Tennis games. I like Waluigi. I think he's a cool character.
What's he sound like when he talks?
Waluigi.
That was pretty good. I'm proud of
it. I've never done that. I'm not even lying. That was like right on the...
Well, and that was perfect. Like, if I listened to a Waluigi right now, I'd be like, that's not him, because Daniel just did his voice. It's clearly not Waluigi. I always played as Yoshi in everything. Like, Mario Kart 64, Yoshi's the best character.
And you always hold the banana, because it makes Yoshi go faster.
Yes, it's true. You have to hold the banana thing, and it makes. And if you get all the banana things, it makes him go even faster. But you make fun of me for that. But what happened last time we played that game against each other?
I'm not good at Mario Kart 64.
Okay.
I'm not good at that game. I was never good at Mario Kart 64.
That's fine.
You're a better Mario Kart 64 player than I am, and that's why you beat me. It's not because you held a banana on the back of your cart.
It was because I held a banana on the back of my cart, because I know how to play Mario Kart 64. And it's by holding a banana on the back of your cart. And just
you do not go faster.
You do. This is our Twitter poll of the
week. We determined that it's because the camera goes back
a little bit. Broquettes, in Mario Kart 64, if you got the banana item and held it on the back of your cart, did you go faster? Yes or no? Do hashtag banana yes or hashtag banana no.
And I'll count them up. My brother and I, when we used to play Double Dash, he used to always be Toad. And I always used to be Waluigi. So we used to always joke that, because the mushrooms always made you go faster.
So do bananas.
When we were like really close to winning, like he always used to joke like, hold on, Dan. And he would hold his toad head against the fucking road behind the car, like drag his fucking head. And it would just be blasted. Or I grab his head and I go, and I put it on the ground right behind the cart.
Boys are terrible and so mean. At least I was holding bananas and not toad heads.
Shoving his fucking head in the concrete.
That's so mean.
These are set to release, I don't know if we said it yet, November 2016. They're already up for pre-order.
Continuing on with the games, but moving back into DC, Telltale Games has released its first images of its upcoming DC game, Batman the Telltale Series. What is that name?
I love the Telltale Games. They are so story-driven, not much gameplay. The Walking Dead one was excellent. I don't even like The Walking Dead, and that's how good a game it was. I really enjoyed playing that.
Which other games have they made?
They've done Jurassic Park in the past. They've done several of The Walking Dead episodes. That's probably been the biggest one that they've done. And The Wolf Among Us with Fables. And that was another one that did extremely well. But now with Batman, there's a quote here.
Quote, we've been hard at work at Telltale creating an all-new iteration of the iconic Batman story that puts players in the suit of billionaire Bruce Wayne just as much as it will put them behind the mask, deciding how to carefully navigate a complex drama rich with action, crime, corruption, and villainy lurking around every corner of Gotham City. This came from Telltale Games. I cannot say that word. CEO/co-founder Kevin Berner.
I think this Telltale game is going to be more of a Be the Batman experience. Mm-hmm. than Rocksteady's VR game. Their stories, their gameplay is way more effective than what a 60-minute VR experience could be. I haven't played VR, I haven't played even the Rocksteady game, but this is, I've played the Telltale games, I know what they can do. And with Batman, I'm extremely excited. I've seen the screenshots, it looks amazing. And I really can't wait. I don't care if this comes out in episodes. I will buy every single episode knowing that there's going to be, in a year, a disc that has all three episodes in one. Does not matter. I want to support this because I want more Batman Telltale games. And the design for this, and it will be a Jim Lee-designed Batman.
So is this going to mix with God of War, where you play as Bruce Wayne and you gotta seduce them ladies?
I don't know about that. Their gameplay isn't quite button mashing. It's more like you make decisions.
I can make decisions as Batman. Choke him out.
Although when we made decisions as Batman in the DLC for Arkham Knight, it ended up being like the sad decision. Like the one with...
Is there ever a happy decision with Batman?
Sometimes there is. Mm. I mean, whatever Batman chooses, we chose what Batman would do. It was in the Ra's al Ghul one.
Yes.
The Ra's al Ghul one ended up being the bad decision where Batman would not let Ra's al Ghul die because he's Batman. And that's what we went with. And that ended up being the bad ending. Like, oh, Nyssa ended up dying and Batman's sad and Ra's got away. But then when we played the other version where you let Ra's die, you take him to Arkham and he says he's proud of you, detective. And that's the ending. And that's the one I thought was the bad one. Because if Ra's is proud of you, then you did something that he would do. And it's always that Batman doesn't do what Ra's would want that makes Ra's, like, love him more. Like, he respects Batman more because Batman can do shit without going through Ra's methods and still stopping him. Like, that's what makes that relationship so dynamic that I felt like, damn it, like, we thought as Batman and we did what Batman the Animated Series Batman would do. And it didn't work. We didn't go the Batman Begins route of, I don't have to save you. No, you fucking do. You're fucking Batman.
You clearly do not like this character at all. I think we will not be getting this game.
I'm playing it. No way I'm not playing this. I am playing it.
A game that I hope you don't play, though. You can play the Batman game. That's fine. I will enjoy that, too. But this next game, I will not fucking enjoy. Mass Effect Andromeda.
I was hoping you'd forget about that.
Nope. It's
Mass Effect Andromeda.
It is Mass Effect Anal Drama. That is the name of this game.
Terrible. I love this title.
Why would you want to play a game about anal drama?
Because it's got Mass Effect's name on it. Right? I don't care if they call it anal drama. I will play Mass Effect.
Mass Effect Anal Drama. That is the best name I've ever come up with for anything. Mass Effect Anal Drama. It just goes together so perfectly.
So terrible.
So truthful.
The team at BioWare wants to bring back the exploration of discovering a new galaxy,
a new races,
and cultures that was felt in the very first Mass Effect.
Can't read this now because you're feeling things with this brand new anus. I'm very confused.
So what would you rename BioWare? The development team behind Mass Effect. Those poor people.
Bootyware. They make Mass Effect. So this is set far from the original Mass Effect galaxy. Anal drama. I'm just gonna... Fine, I'll read it right. Set far from the original Mass Effect galaxy, Andromeda will give players more options and time to explore different planets. While players will play as a human protagonist, you'll be the alien as other species look at you as the different one.
That's going to be awesome. Like, you got some of that in the Mass Effect trilogy, but this is going to be like you are traveling, you're put to sleep, and then you wake up in a whole different part of the universe. And now you are going to be unique to their regions, to their cultures,
always unique, Denny.
And the shepherd, or it's not shepherd, but the main character that you play as, it looks like they're marketing a female protagonist. Whereas in the previous games, they did a male shepherd, and then eventually they marketed some of Femshep. But now they're fully showing what looks to be a female protagonist, at least for the marketing. You'll still be able to choose male or female.
Are you a boy or a girl?
Exactly right. This is set to release in early 2017 on PC, PlayStation 4, and the Xbox One.
With Mass Effect, we are going further than ever before. to Andromeda to build a new home for humanity.
I cannot fucking wait. And they already said they weren't going to show a lot at E3 because they don't want to pull back the curtains on something they don't feel is quite finished or polished. But the fact that they give us this much information, they want us to spend more time on the planets as opposed to, here's this mission, go to this planet. Okay, you're done with the mission, or let's head out. And you can't really revisit it. Now they're saying you get to spend more time, different options, different stories in said planets. So I and the gameplay almost looks like what we had in the previous Mass Effect games. All of that is great because they were initially rumored to make vast changes to the formula.
I feel as though I will feel like a single wife when this game comes out.
I don't know. I'm going to play this at night after you're asleep till fucking 4 or 5 in the morning.
And then you're going to wake up the next morning and be cranky because you were up too late playing video games.
Or be happy because I'll be thinking about all those space adventures I went on and who I'm romancing.
All them space hoes. Can I pick who you romance? Can you romance a nice young man?
If I play as FemShep, or actually I guess both, but the thing is, last time they gave you like 2 options for gay males, and I'm like, I wouldn't have really liked them anyway.
I wanted you to romance Garrus. He was a nice young man.
Garrus, I didn't, I actually romanced both. I romanced Liara, which is both, like they're not male or female, but they have the female form. Female. As FemShep.
Who was the gentleman you romanced?
I didn't romance any guys.
Why didn't you romance any gentlemen? So you can romance a lady as a lady, but you can't romance a gentleman as a gentleman?
I can, but I didn't. Like, I did not. I like Liara a lot. Like, she's my second favorite Mass Effect romance option. And I ended up, I'm like, okay, well, now I can choose, now that I'm playing again as FemShep, I can still choose Liara as my romance option. So it worked out, because I still thought that Liara, story-wise, would have been Shepard's main romance option.
All right, you can play this anal drama game as long as I get to choose who you romance.
All right, and you're going to have to meet all the characters and choose from there.
Yes. And
this
then,
is like your Fire Emblem in space.
And then I'm going to pick the wrong one and then research my beautiful children and cry.
And make me start all over.
Yes. I still have to finish that game. My DS has been on for like a month because I'm stuck in a battle and I haven't finished it.
Just getting updates from the 3DS because it still has the Wi-Fi on?
Yep. No, I turned off the Wi-Fi.
Oh, okay. Well, you better finish that battle.
I know. I need to finish
batteries.
It. Oh, I keep just charging it. Like, it turns orange, and I'm like, oh, charge it.
So that is everything about E3 2016 that we highlighted. If there's something that you are particularly excited for at E3, let us know on Twitter at ReasonsI'mBroke or Facebook.com/TheReasonsI'mBroke.
We do have one thing to cover movie-wise, though, before we move into our Patreon shoutouts and comic book highlights of the week.
According to Suicide Squad director David Ayer, Jared Leto's Joker has tattoos that are designed to tell a story.
Quote, the tattoos tell a very specific story, Ayer told Yahoo Movies, and eventually people will decipher them and understand what's going on. But obviously, they're contentious. Anytime you do something new, it's contentious. There's very specific stories and Easter eggs in those tattoos. And even his teeth. There's an entire story behind that, which is absolutely canon. It's putting his history on his body. This Joker is a little more working class, who I believe could live in our world.
So this made me nervous, because this revitalized that idea that this Joker is going to be Jason Todd, gone insane. They said that, so these tattoos tell a story, then that damaged tattoo on his head is a Robin that's corrupt and damaged that represents that. And all that stupid fucking shit that guy came up with on the internet about, like, oh, this kind of looks like an R in the ha-has, like, all of that shit is now going to get more weight and credibility.
Okay, so give it more weight. Like, I could make up any bullshit. I could be like, oh, this is really Barbara Gordon, who's been damaged because he shot her. Like, there's a million and a half people that you could come up with. And yes, I get why you're telling that story and you're coming up with that, but I don't see it as realistic. He's too old to be Jason Todd.
And they're saying too, like, well, maybe the Joker knocked out his teeth and that's why he has those fake ones. And then when he kills the Joker and he becomes crazy, you know, that's he gets them fixed. I'm like,
Or maybe Batman punched out the Joker's teeth one time, so he put in gold ones.
After he killed Jason Todd, like, yeah. Maybe exactly. Maybe that's what happened. That's a way more fucking interesting connection to it all than this is Jason Todd. And I know the comparison's going to come up of Return of the Joker, where we had a Robin become the Joker in the future. That story's been told, and even then, we didn't really like it. Like, we didn't feel that it fit that whole mythos of the Joker and Batman, because Batman would have noticed immediately, like, you're not the Joker.
You're fucking Jason Todd, yeah.
Well, Tim Drake in that case. So, in this case, I don't know, like, maybe Batman already knows, like, it's Jason Todd, and this is why I can't kill him, and even though the Joker's been killing a bunch of people. I get it. I get sort of the appeal behind it. But I am not a fan of it, and mainly because it all came from someone that made this article over nothing, probably trolling, I don't know, or someone that's so delusional.
You see how trolling damages lives now?
It can, and also it is not to any blame to anyone that I come across, but it's brought up a lot, being that I work at a comic shop, of like, hey, did you hear this theory about Jason Todd and the Joker? I'm like, yeah, I've heard it. And I'm really not a fan of it. If they end up going with it, fine. I'm not going to nerd rage over it. But it's just something that I initially, and I haven't seen the movie, so I don't know what they go with, but I don't believe that that's what it's going to be.
I just don't see the pieces lining up, even if they do that, because Jason Todd would have had to have been the Joker for a really long-ass time at this point, long enough to have corrupted Harley as well, because Harley's not just going to jump on with whatever Joker just because they're the Joker.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I don't know. I just don't see it lining up. I don't think...
Well, and if I wanted to play devil's advocate, they can fit it to where Jason Todd's been the Joker for a few years, then he corrupted Harley, and that's why she's his Joker. Like, they can do all kinds of things like that. But again, I really don't think that that's going to be the story. And if it is, you know, egg on my face, I don't know. But it's not something that I personally, as a Batman fan, find appealing.
Egg on my face. Where have we ever heard, where did you get that from? I've never heard that before.
You've never heard that saying?
No.
That's where if you, like, were wrong about something, and then you're, like, you say, you're very much against something, and you say that's not what it's going to be, and then eventually they're like, no, actually, you're proven wrong by the fact that they come out and they actually did this. You say you have egg on your face, or you're eating crow, or whatever.
So, does this mean, like, when we make bets that I always win, I can throw an egg on your face?
You know what? Yes. That's what it means.
Okay. All right. I like this. I like this phrase now.
Have you ever seen those videos of the guys that have the competition of how many eggs can I crack with my head?
No.
A lot of these idiots don't realize that eggshells are pretty sharp.
Yeah.
So, by the time they get to, like, the sixth, so, like, the third bump, they're bleeding. There's, like, red eggs. And they're still... And they don't notice. But then, like, they start feeling it. And it's like, yeah, you cut up your fucking head. You fucking idiot.
Oh my God.
It's eggs.
Oh, people.
So before our two highlights this week, we do want to give our Patreon shoutouts. And this week it goes out to Neil on Twitter at nmatz68 and to John at john72tex. Please be sure to follow them. Follow all of our Patreon backers and all of our Patreon shoutouts that we give out each week, because these backers, these supporters, are helping to make a higher quality show for all the brocats out there.
And if any of you brocats are listening and say, you know what, yes, I want to help out as well, you can go to patreon.com/thereasonsimbroke. We have different tiers of what you can donate per month. All of them include different perks for our show as well.
For as little as a dollar a month.
A dollar a month.
Dollar a month will give you a shout out every single month. So if you do have something that you do want to promote, we'll take a look at it. Of course, we'll be more than happy to help you out. And there are different tiers, as you mentioned, to get different rewards for supporting the show. We do want to mention, before we talk about how we're reworking the Patreon for this month, is that we do want to thank decalavenue.com for helping us out with the $5 reward tier of the decals.
And of course, guys, our podcast will always be free. You don't have to donate if you don't want to, but you do have to leave us a review and talk to us on Twitter.
Definitely helps us out. The iTunes reviews are awesome. They help us out on bumping up a little bit higher on the Games and Hobbies chart and helps new listeners find us. This month, though, in the wake of the tragedy here in Orlando, we are actually going to take all of our Patreon support this month and we're going to send it on over to support Victims of Pulse Shooting Fund. This was actually set up by Equality Florida Action, Inc., and this is a fund that helps out the families of those affected and those that were affected in the club shooting. Because remember, not people were shot, not everyone died, but the people that did die and the people that did survive, all of them are going to get help from this fund. And not only are we moving all of the every single Patreon dollar, every single penny over to this fund, but for brocats out there, and you may have seen it on the Patreon post, but if you buy a t-shirt at nerdupmedia.com/shop, we are going to match that amount and send it also over to this fund to help these victims of the Pulse shooting. So essentially, $16.99 that is going to be donated, all for matched penny for penny, straight to them, and then you get a t-shirt.
Mm-hmm.
So you donate $16.99, go straight to their fund, and you get a free t-shirt, is the way I like to think about it. And that's just as a huge thanks to all the listeners out there, of course, but also to help out the victims, because we have to help. I mean, we're Orlando has given us so much. Without Orlando the way it is, the podcast would not be quite the same. Politics aside, this is strictly helping victims, helping those affected, and that's not something I feel anyone can argue against.
And with that, guys, we can move into our two comic book highlights this week, and they're two pretty amazing books, I think. First up, we have Detective Comics number 934. This is written by James Tynion IV, with art by Eddie Barrows, and the colorist is Adriano Lucas.
This was the comic that I was extremely excited for. Not the one I was most excited for, fucking Superman.
Mm-hmm.
But this is a comic in which Clayface will team up with the Batman family.
It's so cool.
And that it gave me the inkling of like, oh, please give me like this. I don't want it to just be like, help us because I'm Batman, and otherwise, fuck you, you're gone. But they worked in, James Tynion worked in this sympathetic churn to it. And as I said on Twitter, I'm a fucking sucker for any time they make a villain sympathetic, because there's a deeper dimension to it all. And they've given that to Clayface. Clayface has always been that character, and they've continued to explore that with Detective 934. There's even some humor behind it. It's a light Detective Comics book.
That was my favorite part of this book, too, was Clayface. When they come in, and he's just sitting there watching a movie. He's watching himself on the movie, and huge spoilers. But, you know, he's saying, I'll come with you freely, just let me be who I was for just a little while. And, heart-wrenching.
Because he mentions that this was arguably his best performance.
Mm-hmm.
He was nominated for an Academy Award, or there were rumblings of him being nominated, and of course things went south for him. And now he's saying, like, this is my height. The height of my life is this moment. And people were talking during this movie when I'm trying to enjoy it. So he scared him off, turned into the monster that he believes he is now, and just, you know, watched his previous life, his previous existence. Mm-hmm. And Batman, to his fucking credit, doesn't, you know, shock him or elbow him to his fucking face. He just tells him, you can continue to, I'm not going to take you in for this. It's something along the lines of, you can still be that man and help us out. Like, I love that Clayface is going to be a member of this family. And there's, like I said, that humor of everyone grapples up and he's like, how the hell am I supposed to get up there? Like, someone help Clayface, please. I want you to help him.
someone pick him up. Take him with you.
Is this already a better Detective Comics than the New 52? And we like the New 52.
Mm-hmm.
But Batman was arguably the best Bat book.
Of course. I think this is a fantastic start to it. It's something completely new that we haven't seen before. It's Batman being all shady, like doing these things for a specific reason. And I think we're really going to dive into that. And the very last page, we see a villain that we don't know who it is.
That I'm hoping ends up being a heavy payoff for us. Because mm-hmm. we've seen the Batman knockoff or the Batman wannabe in the past. We've seen that several times in several villains. There's a top 10 list out there of best ex-Batman or best anti-Batmans. And so this looks to be another of that. Mm-hmm. Or they're going to take an older character and rework him into this. And the fact that Azrael is the first one affected, which is one of those anti-Batmans,
right,
it tells us that maybe there is a connection to the past for Batman. So I hope that there is a good payoff in that villain.
Our next book is Wonder Woman Rebirth number 1. This is written by Greg Rucka with art by Matthew Clark, Liam Sharp, and Jeremy Caldwell. And the colorist is Laura Martin.
If it weren't for Wonder Woman Rebirth, Detective Comics would have had the best artwork.
Mm-hmm.
This is a thing of beauty. Like, you flip through this. If you have any copies, if you're lucky enough to have any copies at your local comic book shop, take a moment to flip through Wonder Woman Rebirth number 1. The use of color is astounding. The pencils, the inks, everything works in this book. And I've read the Wonder Woman New 52 run for all the trade paperbacks, and they are fucking fantastic with Cliff Chang as the artist. But this is going to give that a run for its money. If all of these start looking like this Rebirth issue, I mean, it's going to be hard to ever drop this title if the artwork looks that good.
For me, the winner of this book was the story, though. The story was amazing. It took you on this ride of what's real and what's not real, and it was seamless, and I was just hanging on every single word, the way that, you know, it really showed you both of Wonder Woman's lives, essentially, the new 52 and the pre-52, getting to see that duality right next to each other and understand the differences, but a lot of the similarities as well. So I think that was a brilliant way to tie it all back in together and to take it into a place where it's going to go back to the old way to appeal older readers. But at the same time, as someone who loved the new 52 Wonder Woman, I'm excited to see where this goes too, because I feel like they're handling the character in the same way.
It's going to be very hard to drop any DC books for Rebirth if they continue this quality. And I've said this on Twitter, if they do continue and the number maintains and the interest maintains, Indie and Marvel are going to have to be cut, because if they deserve these sales if they're putting out these stories. And I've heard the same notion from customers, which is very bizarre, because simply a month ago, before Rebirth launched, we heard negativity. We read it on the internet. Mm-hmm. I heard it in the comic book shop of, oh, great, another relaunch, another reboot. Well, it happened 5 years ago, so you might be thinking of Marvel. But it was such negativity because, again, as I've said, the Marvel movies, Disney, is on top right now. Mm-hmm. The books, of course, are going to reflect that. People are going to be more drawn to the Marvel books because they saw the movie. They want to read the books, which is fine, and it's great. But DC has done this move now with Rebirth where they've caught the old readers, they've maintained the new readers, and they're putting out good stories. And they're selling out of everything. In the Marvel and DC totals, whenever we have Rebirth in stock, it's outselling Marvel, which hasn't happened in fucking years. It's very bizarre and it's very weird for me because not only are we outselling that stuff, but people are positive about DC Comics. And it's so weird to me. It's just like, oh, they're doing good. Like, I'm not a DC reader and I'm picking up DC books. Or, yeah, they got me back. Like, this feels like pre-New 52. This doesn't feel like the New 52. This is my Batman. And I'm like, Jesus, what is going on? Like, I'm still enjoying these and they're great.
Right.
But everyone else is happy too. So I'm like, this is not normal. Normally,
Dr. people are, Manhattan, what did you do?
Comic readers are very, very negative. Like, this is weird to me.
But I mean, that's good. It's awesome. Very good. That's what we
very
want.
Very good. Very uneasy, but very good. Thank you, as you said, Manhattan. Thank you, Jeff Johns. I hope they maintain this momentum moving forward, and hopefully this is a brand new era of DC Comics.
And with that, guys, we can wrap up our podcast. The podcast. It's very late. I cannot do the speaking. That does wrap up our podcast for this week.
Don't forget to follow us on Twitter once again at Reasons I'm Broke, facebook.com/TheReasonsI'mBroke. But for a link of everywhere you can find us, head on over to TheReasonsI'mBroke.com.
Once again, guys, thank you so much for listening. I'm Kelly.
And I'm Daniel.
We'll see you next week.